The reason why we're going today is because about 15 years ago, I was in Botswana on another tour. And the tour guide, in the first meeting that he had with all of us, he went around to each person and he asked, "What do you want to see? What animal do you want to see?" And of course, everybody says something like, elephant, lion, giraffe. And from the tour guide's point of view, that's going to be like shooting fish in a barrel. So when he gets to me, I say, "Pangolin." And he's stunned. You see, he told me later that in his entire life, and he had been a guide for a very long time, he'd only seen one pangolin in the wild. And of course, on that trip, I didn't see a pangolin. As a matter of fact, every safari that I've taken, or almost every safari, I have asked about whether or not we could see a pangolin, or whether there was one in the area that had been seen. And I have never seen a pangolin in the wild. And you're not going to see them in zoos either. And the reason is because pangolin are very, very fragile. They die very, very quickly under most normal zoo-type situations. So you're not going to see one in the zoo, and you're very, very unlikely to see one in the wild. So the next question is, what is a pangolin? What does it look like?
Pangolins, or scaly anteaters, are the world's only scaly mammals. Their scales are made of keratin, which is the same as human hair and nails, and rhino horn. Pangolins have long, powerful claws that are perfect for ripping open ants' nests, and super long, sticky tongues to pick up ants and termites. When attacked, pangolins roll up in an impenetrable ball to protect themselves. However, this doesn't help them defend against poachers who can just pick them up. There are 8 species of pangolin in total, 4 of which occur in Asia and 4 in Africa. All of them are threatened with extinction. In many instances, this is because of increasing demand for their meat, which is considered a delicacy in some places. They are literally being eaten out of existence. In traditional Chinese medicine, pangolin scales are also believed to treat a wide variety of conditions. Pangolins are now thought to be the world's most illegally trafficked wild mammal, with more than 1 million estimated to have been snatched from the wild in the past decade.
There are a couple of other little things that are interesting about pangolin as well. This coat is on display at the Royal Armouries in Leeds. It's made out of pangolin scales. It's from Rajasthan in India, probably early 19th century or so. This coat was covered with the scales of the pangolin. The scales had been decorated in gold, and the larger have been used where more protection is required. This is the only known example of this type of armor. It originally also had a helmet made out of pangolin scales with 3 plumes. The scale coat was presented to King George III in 1820 by Francis Rowden. He was the first Marquis of Hastings, and he was also the East India Company's Governor General in Bengal in 1812 to 1822.
Okay. I would have done this myself, but I'm afraid of heights.
Oh boy, here we go again.
Why don't you mind your own business?
You can do it!
He's just gonna run away.
Not this one.
As soon as the monkeys get stung, they always run away.
He's not a monkey.
What is he?
A man cub.
A man cub?
Yeah, and can you keep your voice down? I'm trying to concentrate.
Everything going A-OK up there!
Oh boy, looks like you got another one.
Buzz off.
That's a man cub.
A man cub?
Yeah, it's a man cub.
It's not a monkey.
No, it's a man cub.
You have never been a more endangered species than you are at this moment.
You're doing an amazing job.
Getting stuck. Oh boy, here we go again.
It's not a monkey, Fred.
It's a man cub.
A man cub?
Yeah, it's a man cub.
Can you believe it?
Are you sure?
Would you please shut up? Hey, up there. Everything is going fantastically, I see.
Ow! You got it. Believe in yourself.
There you go.
Ow!
Come on. Almost. Yeah! Yeah! Oh, yeah!
Uh-oh. Oh. Fred?
That's the first part.
Got it. That's the first part!
Now, the next question is, once you've decided what a pangolin looks like and that you want to see one, and I decided that I really did want to see a pangolin, it wasn't just a joke anymore, then the next question is, when or where are you going to see a pangolin? Well, pangolin exist in Asia and in Africa. There's about 8 different species of them. But we're going to be going to the ones in Africa. Now, the next question is, when do you go? Well, I asked that question, and as I understand it, pangolin are most active in the winter. So that's why we're going in June and July, because in southern Africa, that's when winter is. But now specifically, where do you go? Well, I caught a view of a video clip that gave me a hint where to go.
Pangolins, they have been called the world's most trafficked animal you've never heard of. Notoriously difficult to rehabilitate and release, one woman in Namibia is getting it right, thanks to lessons learned from this one little pangolin. This is Katiti, the pangolin. His name means small or little in the Namibian language of Herero. Katiti was born here at the Rare and Endangered Species Trust, or REST, in Otjiwarongo, Namibia. He's a male pangolin with a close bond to Maria Diekman, the founder of the sanctuary, and one of the few people in the world to have successfully raised, rescued, and released pangolins back into the wild. Very little is known about these shy and elusive creatures. Pangolins are scaly anteaters, and there are 8 species which live in Africa and Asia. Most are endangered, or critically endangered. Here at REST, Katiti is completely at home, and he spends most of his day in the natural habitat around the sanctuary's headquarters, foraging and doing what any wild pangolin would do. Another aspect of Maria's work is gathering scientific data about pangolins. She and her team record everything that Katiti does during the day, gathering samples and data that can help the species as a whole in the future. Katiti's presence at REST is invaluable, but it takes a lot of dedication to look after a pangolin. As soon as he wakes up in the morning, Katiti is taken out to forage as he would in the wild. And while he's busy doing all of that, all day, every day, the team follows Katiti, who is tagged with a GPS monitor, to monitor his whereabouts at all times. And wherever Katiti goes, so does the team. But, like most of the pangolins that come into Maria's care, Katiti has a sad story, which starts when his mother was rescued from the illegal wildlife trade.
So we got a wild black market pangolin. She had probably been carried around in a box for about a week. She was terrified of humans. She had not eaten. She was very dehydrated. And I let her out of this box, and for whatever reason, this animal immediately bonded with me. She started to eat and she started to drink, so we figured we had 4 days. That was the goal, because usually when a wild pangolin comes in, you release them within hours. You don't keep them because they don't do well. So at day two, I walked in and she had had Katiti. She had just given birth. And I just had such a bond. She would bring little Katiti to me. We had a very hands-off approach with him. Only once a day, I would pick him up for about 30 seconds and weigh him. Other than that, she did all of the care for him. But eventually, after a couple of weeks, she would actually bring him to me.
But one day, Katiti's mom disappeared.
One day, she just never came back. And he went into panic mode. He wouldn't eat, he wouldn't drink. I finally got him, you know, taking a little bit of yogurt. We finally got him eating ants, and every single day I'd weigh him 3 times a day, and every single time I weighed him, his weight would go down. So I was losing him. I was terrified. You know, you got this little tiny creature that you've spent 2.5 months with, and you have nobody to call.
Pangolins are exceptionally difficult to keep in captivity, and only a handful of people have ever gotten it right.
Yeah, there's a reason that there's only 3 people in the world that have held pangolin for longer term, or at least African pangolin. And that's because it is by far the hardest animal in the world. It's to raise or to hold. They have very specific needs. They are incredibly susceptible to stress. They don't do well with humans. They don't do well with a captive diet. So you need a place like this. You can't have a zoo environment. They've tried. You can't have a small little, you know, 10 hectares. They've tried.
The fact that pangolins can't be raised in captivity or farmed means that all the pangolins in the illegal wildlife trade came from the wild. It's estimated that over 1 million pangolins from Africa and Asia have been trafficked in the last 10 years. Pangolin scales are prized in traditional Asian medicine, and their flesh is considered a delicacy. It's been said that pangolins are literally being eaten into extinction. Back here at rest in Namibia, Maria and her team are always on hand to rescue and rehabilitate pangolins from the illegal trade. And Maria believes that their success rate is due to Katiti's presence in their home.
I probably smell like a pangolin. My house certainly smells like a pangolin. And it's probably all good hormones, because Katiti is at home there. That's his home. So when these wild pangolins come in, they have a feeling of, wow, this is actually a pangolin environment. I can relax a little bit. Or at least that's my impression. Because we're so successful with wild pangolins coming in and basically almost crawling on top of me within usually a half hour to 24 hours. Now, it's not the satisfaction of them crawling on top of me. What it is a satisfaction that once they trust me, I can get them to eat and I can get them to drink. So if I can get them to trust me within 24 hours, I can get them out here foraging on their own. So it's a huge, huge step. And I think Katiti is a huge part of that, you know, getting these wild pangolins relaxed enough. But you've got to do it fairly quickly, because the whole goal is to get that animal back out as fast as possible.
There is still so much to learn about these strange little creatures, and it would be devastating to lose the species before we can. Which makes the work of the Rare and Endangered Species Trust and lessons learned from Katiti absolutely invaluable.
Now, as a result of seeing this video clip, I started looking for Maria Diekman. And I found her. I sent her an email. And she's stationed now at Etosha. Now, Etosha is in Namibia. So we're going to go to Namibia and we're going to see a habituated, probably almost domesticated pangolin. But this time, we're almost certain of seeing one. Next, from Etosha, we go a little bit south to Maria Diekman's place, where she has the organization REST. This is where she does rehabilitation of rare and endangered species. And she had started out not with pangolin, but she kind of got into that by accident. This is an overview of REST and the area that surrounds it. One thing that's fairly clear is that there appears to be enough for a pangolin to eat here. Maria, how did you get in this business?
Well, to make a very long story short, I actually came over to Namibia to look at the political situation. I was working in Washington, D.C. in politics, and I wanted to look at what was happening in Southern Africa. And the second day in the country, I met my future husband, who was a cattle rancher, an engineer for the government at the time, but his family was cattle ranchers. And one thing led to another. 3 years later, we got married, ran a cattle ranch for a number of years, and then saw a need for a bird called the Cape Griffin vulture, the most endangered animal in this country. And it was on the cliffs very, very close to where our farm was. And I thought I'd start this sort of small little organization that would help a few birds, you know, and bring some people in and do a few little things. And that's how REST started. And then, you know, one day a pangolin came in, and you know, one day a bat came in, and we've actually just started working with a number of different species. Mm.
Now, as I understand it, you've got a couple of pangolin now in your care. Is that right?
Yeah, we don't usually talk about numbers for security reasons, same as the rhino people. But I do have two permanent pangolins at the moment. One is being raised. She's been with me since she was a baby. So she's being prepared for the wild. And then another one came in with a very serious injury. Mm. So he's not able to forage 100% for his own food. So he forages every day for a couple of hours, but then he also stays with us.
And the one that's the permanent, uninjured pangolin, that's Honey Bun, I take it.
Yeah, that's Honey Bun. And hopefully she's not permanent. You know, she's been with me for 3 years. She was actually out in the wild for a number of months, and she chose to come back to us. We're not quite sure why yet. We're looking at a couple of different reasons, maybe because it was winter and it was just getting cold or what, but she's chosen to return to us a couple of months ago, and we're holding her, and she essentially lives like a wild pangolin. Mm. She only has the benefit that she comes in at night and has a safe, warm place to sleep.
Okay, and the other pangolin, how did you come by it?
Well, he's my miracle baby. He escaped from poachers. He was in an industrial area, and you know those buildings have those very high, small windows. Mm. So he must have found a way. They're real Houdinis. They can climb anything. He found a way to climb up to the window from the inside, and then obviously fell a considerable distance on the outside and severed his leg from his spine. So it was quite a serious injury. The vets couldn't operate because usually for an injury like that, they come from the back, and a pangolin has scales, so it's quite an unusual animal to operate on. Nobody's quite experienced with that. So they basically said he's either going to survive or he's going to die, and he chose to survive. So he's got a bit of a limp, but he's just an amazing, amazing creature.
So as I understand it, the leg separated from the hip, is that right?
Yeah, it's called a total femoral spinal fracture, but literally right where the leg attaches to the spinal column, it's separated.
And it's still separated?
No, it's healing. Bones are amazing, especially on young animals. They can heal quite well. That's why we have such success with our small antelope that come in and have broken legs, because, you know, small bones. But on a big adult like Amos, it's not easy, especially because for 6 weeks, he could not move around a lot. It needed to calcify. So the bone isn't up perfectly aligned, but it's aligned enough and calcium is forming there that he actually gets around. But for a pangolin, a wild pangolin, who was terrified of me when he first came in, you know, it was quite a challenge. I put my mattress on the floor so that he could get in and out of it, because he had to bond with me. Mm. Or he had to choose whether or not he would bond with me. If he hadn't, he would be dead now. So he chose to bond with me, and we slept on the floor, and he could get in and out to me as he got used to me, and it was able to heal in those 6 weeks, or at least enough that it can start to continue to heal.
Thank you very much.
No, it was an absolute pleasure.
This is the Cape Griffin vulture species that Maria started out with. Maria has a couple of them in her care right now, a male and a female, and they are hoping for eggs. The young lady seems to be interested in building a nest, so the possibility of chicks may not be all that remote.
Big, but not too big. It could be the white head owl. Maybe a Verrocks owl is a little bit big.
I think
it could be the white faced rather.
Honey Bun isn't the only animal that's been released from the rest that has returned. These warthogs also came back. They're not fed. They just stick around because they like being here. And here's our first look at one of Maria's pangolin. That was Amos, the pangolin with the injured leg. Incidentally, he weighs about 20 pounds. And this is Honey Bun. Honey Bun is about 15 pounds or so. Both of these pangolin are Cape pangolin. They're not nearly the largest pangolin. The largest pangolin is the giant ground pangolin, and it can go up around the size of, the weight of a small human being, adult human being. We're going to be following Honey Bun as she goes through her daily routine. Basically, what she's doing is foraging for food. She collects her own ants and termites for the most part. Thank you. Chinese companies are said to be working on a breeding program for pangolin on a large scale so that they have a steady supply. But the problem is that no one has really figured out how to breed pangolin on a commercial scale. Like I said, they're very fragile. Most pangolin don't survive more than a few days or a few hundred days maybe in captivity, let alone breed and give birth. Most of those Chinese companies are suspected to be simply a cover for the illegal wildlife trade. There are, however, six zoos and a nonprofit in the United States that have imported 46 pangolin from Togo in 2016, aiming to study the animals under controlled conditions and establish a self-sustaining population. As of early March, 16 of those had died already.
She could be in a fragile state. She could be pregnant, so I'm just concerned about that.
You've probably already noticed that the honey bun, when she walks on her rear two legs for the most part. And for the most part, she holds her front arms up above the ground. That's to keep those claws sharp for digging. Unlike honey bun, Amos, the pangolin with the leg that had been broken and is healing, Amos has a slight limp when he walks, and it's fairly noticeable. And that way you can tell the difference between Honeybun and Amos on the screen. This, of course, is Amos. Amos also has to use his front legs more than Honeybun does because of that weak rear leg that had been separated from the spine. Now, of course, both Amos and Honeybun just love to dig. That's what they live for. I mean, quite literally. And in this particular case, we've got an aardvark hole, a hole made by a much larger animal. But that won't stop the pangolin from digging in that hole if it's inclined to do so. The dirt is quite soft here, although they can dig in rather rocky, gravelly, and hard soil as well. But of course, when they're down in those burrows, we can't see them. And occasionally, it would be helpful to be able to see what they're doing, so I brought with me lizard cam. And I ended up giving it to Maria so that she can use it. She was thrilled by the gift, I think.
Okay, now it's almost coming out.
Now here's something I really didn't expect. Honey Bun, during the filming, repeatedly approached me. Maria says this is not something that normally occurs. She got so close that frequently I had to stop filming. In this next clip, you see Honey Bun actually moving into my shadow. That behavior is a little bit hard to explain because at this point at least, since Honey Bun was my first pangolin, I could not have smelled like pangolin. So it was curious, although perhaps less curious, that Amos did the same thing. He also approached me while I was filming, although perhaps what he was smelling was honey bun.
If everyone could try and sort of stay behind him, just so we know what she's going to do.
And yes, those are my shoes in the video. The pangolins were coming right up to my feet. Oh, and when pangolin get really, really relaxed, their tongue completely comes out, and it's very long. It could be about as long as the pangolin itself.